So the third disadvantage is going to be the host to network layer is not a layer. That means here also the data link layer and physical layer is normally going to get combined in the case of the TCP/IP protocol. Therefore, there is no specific kind of a host to network layer is really going to be there existing in the protocol stack. So therefore, the host to network layer is not a layer at all in the normal sense. It is simply an interface. So that means it is not the host to network connectivity is not going to be a layer, especially for the connectivity, just like a physical layer provided in the OSI model. So therefore, that is what one more direct connectivity cannot be done. Okay, it is not going to be like, you know, OSI model, which is specifically meant for the connectivity. TCP/IP model does not even mention the physical and data link layers. That means whatever we do in a physical layer and data link layer, we have to really do it in the single layer. That is called host to network layer. A proper model should include both as separate layers. So these are the certain drawbacks which we are going to have. Now, when you compare these two here, what we can see immediately that the application layer, presentation layer, session layer of the OSI model is combined in the TCP/IP protocol stack, and it provides various services like internet service, FTP protocol service, DNS service. All of them are really named as the application layer itself. Then transport layer, the transport layer used in the OSI, used in the you know this TCP/IP is going to be same. Both of them are going to support TCP protocols and UDP protocols, transmission control protocols, as well as user datagram protocols. Both of them are going to be same in the case of OSI as well as in the case of the TCP/IP layer. The another one is going to be what? Network layer. Here the network layer name has been given as something like a internet layer. So this internet layer is almost all same as the network layer, which is responsible for transmitting the packet from one node to another node. Even though we have different types of networks, underlying networks going to be there between the two computers. Let the networks of any type, let the computers are going to be of any type, let the type of switches, routers going to be of any type in the in the intermediate nodes, the signal is simply going to get transmitted from one node to the other node. That is what which is going to happen in the network layer. Then in the OSI model, if you see, data link layer and physical layer are combined as a host to network layer, which supports the LAN con the LAN trans the LAN connections systems, X.25 connection type of the systems. So this is what the comparison in terms of the architecture of the OSI and the TCP/IP layer architecture. The next thing we're going to have is going to be the other differences between these two. What we can think of other differences between these two as? The OSI has got 7 layers, but TCP has got only 4 layers. Transport layer guarantees delivery of packets in the case of the OSI model. In the case of this TCP/IP, transport layer does not guarantee the delivery of the packets in the case of the TCP/IP protocol layer. That is another difference. And the OSI model supports the horizontal approach. It is going to support the vertical approach. Separate session layer will be there in OSI model. In TCP/IP, there is no layer for the session at all. Even though you're performing the session operations, but still session layer is not at all there in the TCP/IP layer. Therefore, there is no session layer. So the characteristics of session layer are provided by the transport layer itself. Separate presentation layer is provided. There is no presentation layer. Characteristics of presentation are supported by the are provided by the application layer here. Network layer provides both the connectionless and connection-oriented services. Here, network layer provides only connectionless service. So this is the reason why the transport layer does not guarantee delivery of packets, because there is no dedicated connection provided by the network layer in the case of the TCP/IP protocol stack. So here in the case of OSI, network layer provides both connectionless and connection-oriented services. So in the case of TCP/IP, it does not clearly distinguish between the services, interfaces, and protocol. Just now we discussed, there is no clear-cut distinction between the interfaces and protocols between various layers. Here in the case of OSI, definitely that has to be there. Then it is not easy to replace protocols in the case of TCP because there is no clear-cut interfaces between the various protocol stacks. So that's what, once again, it is not easy to replace the protocols, whereas in the case of OSI, protocols are better hidden and can be easily replaced as technology changes. So the plug-in pay is going to be more suitable in the case of this particular OSI model in comparison to TCP/IP protocol layer. TCP/IP cannot be used for any other applications other than the internet-based applications. Okay, and a simple computer-to-computer communication. OSI is truly going to be a general-purpose model. So the model does not fit any other protocol stacks. Tomorrow, some changes are normally going to take place in technology, but it really cannot fit into the technologies. It has a problem of protocol fitting into the protocol. So it is a problem of protocol fitting into the model. So tomorrow I want to incorporate some other protocols into the existing protocols in OSI model. That is not going to be a problem. That is going to be a problem because everything is simply all layers are simply formed based on its basic protocols. So whereas in the case of this, the model does not fit any other protocol stacks. It also same problem is going to exist. So TCP IP is normally going to get supported here. IP protocols, TCP is supported directly here. OSI does not support internet working directly. So the TCP IP is loosely layered protocols because many other layers are inbuilt in the case of the TCP IP, whereas it is not inbuilt in OSI. Therefore, strict layering is normally found in the case of the OSI type of the modeling. So these are the various differences which we can think of in the case of the OSI and TCP/IP protocols. Next, we go and discuss about the types of switchings that can be there in the data communication networks. Now, we'll go with the switching that can be performed in the data communication systems. We discussed in the earlier sessions that the advantages of the data communication system over the postal system. What is the advantage of data communication system? Data communication system supports complex routing methods. It supports long distance communications. It supports multiple technologies. It supports different types of data formats. So all these are the advantages of the computer to computer communication, are called as data communications. So that means when two computers are communicating, what is the distance between the two computers? It can be any distance between the two computers. So therefore, it is normally meant for very long distance communications. Under complex networks, you can transmit your data from one type of network to another type of complex networks. It is very easy in doing that by using the computer to computer communication. So in that process, how we normally going to switch the data from one type of network to another type of network? When data is getting transmitted from one type of network to another type of network, switching is going to take place. Now there are two types of switchings which are going to be popular, known as circuit switching and packet switching type of the networks. So as the name indicates, circuit switching, it is normally comes under kind of a dedicated kind of connections in the case of the circuit switching. In the very olden days, you're going to have the wired telephone connections, normally done by using the analog communication techniques. So where there should be a wired connection between the host telephone to the message switching center, and from message switching center, once again, you're going to have a wire to the destination mobile destination handheld telephone systems. So thereby we normally going to have a wire to wire wired communication systems. So there that communication is simply called as a kind of a dedicated connection. We always going to have a dedicated connection in the case of the olden days 1G analog communication systems. So those communication systems comes under 1G communication system, normally meant for analog communications or voice communication systems. So that's there comes the concept called as circuit switching. So circuit switching is simply a kind of a dedicated connection between the source and the destination computer. That means it is going to be a perfectly established connection before the conversation between the two systems. That is what called circuit switching in general. So the other way around is going to be what called packet switching. Packet switching is not going to be a dedicated kind of a connection. That is the primary difference between the circuit switching and packet switching. Now when you go into that, we can just simply figure out many types of the differences between the circuit switching and the packet switching type of the connections. So we have two types of technologies involved in the switching method. One is going to be the connection oriented technology. Next one is going to be a connectionless type of the technology. So here in the circuit switching is normally is a connection oriented technology based kind of switching. So circuit switching is connection oriented. That means a path is established between source and destination computers before the transmission occurs. So that means what? Before there is a transmission, in the case of circuit switching, we are normally going to establish a connection between the two computers. In the case of packet switching, it is basically a connectionless kind of a service or a technology used. That means a dynamic route is decided for each packet while the transmission is going to take place. So every time, whenever a packet is going to get transmitted dynamically, a route is normally going to get established for that packet to take the path. So every packet from a router or from a switch is going to take different routes. That route is totally decided dynamically, whereas here route is not decided dynamically, it is predefined. That is the advantage, that is the difference here. Then circuit switching was originally designed for voice communications. As I was talking to you, it is originally generated from the voice communications called as 1G or analog, pure analog communications. Packet switching is originally designed for the data communications. Circuit switching is inflexible. As one path is established for transmission, it doesn't change while the duration of the session. So what is the drawback of the circuit switching? It is inflexible. If the path is decided for a communication, that path has to be there throughout the communication. In between, you really cannot change the path. Say, for example, if that path has damaged while the transmission is taking place, then you cannot have another path for the conversation in the case of the circuit switched connection type. Coming to packet switching is very much flexible, as each packet may travel through different routes to reach to the destination. If one route is not working or broken, the packet is going to take several other routes to reach to the destination. But that is not the case in the case of the circuit switching. If the network is not working, then the communication cannot be made in the case of the circuit switching. Okay, then that means in the case of circuit switching, the entire message is received as it is sent from the sender to the receiver. So the best example of circuit switching is going to be the connection given by the internet service provider to each and every house. He's going to have a switch connected between your house to the internet service provider. If there is a damage to the physical connection to that particular service provider wire, then you really cannot have a internet to your house. That means what? Why it is happening? Because it is a circuit switching based type of the connection. It is inflexible. You cannot have another route to have the interrupted internet service for you. You have to simply halt yourself until that wire is going to get repaired or rectified. Until the problem is going to get rectified, you have to live with it compulsorily. Coming to the circuit packet switching, imagine if that is also going to be a packet switched based connection or a wireless connection, then definitely you're normally going to have a uninterrupted internet service. So in packet switching, each packet travels a different route and hence packets are received out. Now, one more problem here is that in circuit switching, the entire message is received as it is sent from the sender to receiver. So as there is a dedicated connection kind of a thing between sender and receiver, so all the packets are received in order at the receiver. Whereas in packet switching, as each packet is going to travel in different paths sended by the sender, the packets are received out of order at the receiver. And later on, they are arranged in the order in the receiver side. So that is what some of the differences which we can have. But the problem here in the packet switching is that the receiver has to rearrange the packets according to the order of the packets. That is what the problem here. And space switching, space division switching or time division switching can be used to implement the circuit switching. So this is what important point here. Space division switching. Space division switching and circuit switching, time division switching is normally going to. So what we can say is that the space division switching or time division switching can be used to implement the circuit switching concept. So circuit switching, packet switching are the concepts. They can be implemented by incorporating some of the techniques known as time division switching technique or space division switching techniques. Coming to the packet switching, can be implemented using two approaches known as the datagram approach and virtual circuit approach. So these two are the differences here. Then circuit switching is always implemented at physical layer. Yeah, this is important. Circuit switching is always implemented at the physical layer, whereas packet switching is always implemented at the network layer. So these two are the primary differences here between these two. So next is for voice transmissions, circuit switching is more efficient than the packet switching. If at all we want to transmit only voice signals, then we prefer circuit switching than the packet switching networks. For data communications, we prefer packet switching, okay, which is going to be more efficient than the circuit switching type of the networks. So these are the differences between the circuit switching and the packet switching type of the networks in the data communications. Okay. So thank you very much for the today's session. Please post the attendance after watching the complete video. And in this video, I am making two videos separately due to the technical problems. I'm making the two videos separately, but these two correspond to the single class only. Okay. So please post the attendance after watching video one and video two. And this is the video two, second class for us. So please go through these two and post the attendance for these two as a single attendance in a single attendance link. Thank you very much for the today's session.